Today my topic is the massive pressure. That sounds a little. A massive pressure. We don't speak to your neighbor and say a massive pressure. God's call to the massive pressure. Reading is taken from Luke chapter 6. 45 I will read first. A good man, can you read that together? Can the PowerPoint come up? Luke chapter 6, 45. We'll read 45 first. A good man out of the good treasure. Are you reading together? A good man out of the good treasure of his heart brings forth the good. An evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart brings forth the evil. For out of the abundance of the heart, his mouth speaks. So this meditation, reflection and our interaction on the word of God is to be filled with good treasure. Will you say, be filled with good treasure? And here is in the methodology, 35. But love, shall we read that together? But love your enemies and do good and lend expecting nothing in return. Shall we repeat? Expecting nothing in return. And your reward will be great and you will be sons of the Most High, for He is kind to the ungrateful and the evil. Be merciful even as your Father is merciful. Judge not and you will not be judged. Condemn not and you will not be condemned. Forgive and you will be forgiven. Give and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over will be put into your lap. Actually, the correct translation is bosom. For with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you. So here is the treasure that our worth and value, our Father in heaven has made us His sons and daughters, and there is a reward. So the good measure is that when we are born again, we become a child of God. Good measure, child of God. Then He has rewards above it, beyond it, that there'll be a running over measure. So we have, will you say it me, good measure and a running over measure, overflowing measure. And that overflowing measure are the rewards that God has for us, and we are going to look at this in detail. Now, there was a son who inherited a land from his father, which he inherited from his father. This was a large bit of land, but it was infertile. Nothing would grow on that land. So his father said on the dying bed, "Son, I am sorry, I have not earned much, but this is our ancestral land. This is what I got from my father, and as your father, I am giving it to you. Do the best you can with it. I have nothing more saved to give you." So the son accepted it with honor from the father, and he tried to do some cultivation. He could not do anything. He tried to get a market value. So he just left the land alone, and for 3 years he traveled all over looking for some upkeep, a job that could finance himself and his family. He just made ends to meet. He could not save anything, did not make much. It was a hand-to-mouth existence. And he came back very disappointed, very angry. And he said, "All this is because of this land. I'm going to sell it." And he sold it for a song. And he moved to another part of the country. But he was so angry and disappointed with what his father had given. And then the new owner did a check why nothing would grow on this land. And then he prospected for, you would have heard this story. Haven't heard? Not heard? He prospected for oil, and the man became a billionaire. So the treasure was beneath his feet and he missed it. Tell your neighbor, we don't want to miss the treasure God has put into us. What is the treasure God has put into us? That He has made us His sons and daughters, and He has, in making us His sons and daughters, He has also put this great reward into us. Your reward will be great, and you will be sons of the Most High. And this reward involves
The love of God He sheds abroad in our heart. Love of God is the treasure we have, and trust is the platinum card that we draw from the love of God. Are you going to write that down? Love of God is the treasure we have. It's such a treasure that He gives us a platinum card to draw out of it. I don't know whether there is something better than the platinum card. I don't know. Is there something better than a platinum card? Is it the highest card? Something bigger than that? What's it? But infinite card. So change it to infinite card. That's quite appropriate for my message. A treasure, and there is an infinite card. Thank you. There's the treasure the Lord has given us, the love of God shed abroad in our heart by the Holy Spirit, and trust. Will you say it with me? Trust. Love of God and trust. To draw out from this treasure lifelong, and it's, what's the name of the card? What's the name of the card? Infinite card. It won't be a misnomer when you say this is drawable to heaven. What is this card about? Even to infinity it works. Infinity is beyond our life, next life. This card works, the love of God and what we can draw from. Now, if love of God is the good treasure, what was the other treasure called? There was another man, you remember? There's a good man with a good treasure who drew out of his good treasure with the infinity card, infinite card. And there was another man who had a, what was his treasure? Evil treasure. I'm suggesting to you, love and trust is the excellent treasure. Fear and mistrust is the evil treasure. Unknowingly to us in our life journey, we draw a mixed baggage. Sometimes we move in love and trust. Other times we move in fear and mistrust. It happens so imperceptibly and intermingling. Sometimes we move in love and trust. Other times we move in fear and mistrust. If you check back, was there a time in your childhood when in the midst of trust and love, you didn't bargain for it, you didn't expect it, something happened that really brought fear and mistrust into you? Childhood. You were loving, you were trusting, you were loved, much loved, but something happened that brought mistrust and fear. Love and trust. Fear and mistrust. Did you understand that? Something in childhood. And today, we are going to get the victory over it. Then I want to ask this question. What was in your adulthood, what was the most distressingly trembling time you have had that you can remember? In adulthood, some moment, occasion, which really, really, you felt as if all strength left you. All strength left you. You wished nobody to come near you, you'd have broken down and cried. You were trembling, you know, you were trembling. You didn't want to see anyone. Anyone seeing your weakness like that, you didn't want to, isn't it? Jesus says in this passage, did you observe that? Give to everyone who asks. Give your and from him who takes away your cloak, 29. I didn't read it yet. To him who strikes you on the one cheek, offer the other also. And from him who takes away your cloak, do not withhold your tunic. Cloak is the outer garment which you wear for a journey. In the past, the cloak would indicate that person's stature. It was an additional, you know, the way we wear a jacket. Tunic is the inner garment. If someone takes your inner garment, what happens to you? your nakedness is exposed. So in this passage, some things Jesus is speaking literally, some things Jesus is speaking metaphorically. So the three things he says is, to him you, 29, to him who strikes you on the one cheek, offer the other also. Is it literal or metaphorical? What is it? If he hits you on one cheek, offer the other cheek. Do you think it's literal or you understand the word metaphorical? You know, what do you think it is? How many of you think it's literal? How many of you think it's metaphorical? I think it's metaphorical. You know, he's not saying, probably it's metaphorical. So the second one is also metaphorical. From him who takes away your cloak, outer garment, don't withhold your tunic also. That's what Jesus did on the cross. Yes? That's what Jesus did on the cross. And we might have been brought to situations we felt as even our inner garment was taken. Did you understand? And that brought trembling, fear, shame, embarrassment. But Jesus says, I love you, you trust me. Say with me, what did Jesus say? I love you, you trust me. I love you, you trust me. Now think about this. What comes first? Love or trust? Whom do you most love in your young days? Father and mother. So I often, when I lecture, I say, don't bring into a child's life anything that creates brand loyalty. Ben 10, Superman, different things the child really gives his heart to will rob that child's little heart of loyalty. And you know, children are absolutely loyal, correct? Children are very loyal. They are die-hard loyalists. They'll give their life to their father and they mean it. They wait for their father to come home. Same with daughters. They are die-hard loyalists. Don't allow that to be robbed by anything or any other person because that's formative in their character. But I'm asking about the incident that you might have felt that your innermost being was violated. I had an incident soon after we came to Colombo from our mud hut. We got the Colombo house and we came to Colombo. And I had a motorcycle. And there was this very precious raincoat, which was with a trouser and an overcoat. It completely clad me. And on my motorcycle, I could go anywhere without getting wet. And we had a lot of traveling to do. And if Hiranti sits behind, we were very thin at that time, okay? If Hiranti sits behind, even she gets covered, you know what I mean? If you have been on a motorcycle, you are riding, you know, the rain comes on the person who is riding and the person behind is quite covered. So it was very precious. We had just moved to Visakha Road and in Gonavala, we had been living for 5, 6, 7 years. Gonavala Sunil was our neighbor and we lost nothing. We didn't have proper door and we just kept the door together. It was a broken down door, no proper hinges, and from inside we kept a chair saying even if a robber comes into the house, he will leave something and go because we were so poor. But in Colombo, first week, I had kept the motorcycle out and I covered it with my precious raincoat, which was very important for our mission travels. Can you understand? And someone brought it from abroad and gave it to us as a gift. It was at that time not available in Sri Lanka. So this raincoat was very precious. Has there been something very precious to you like that? Besides your children? Simple thing, but it was precious. One morning when I got up, my mirrors were gone. Raincoat was gone. Fear came into my heart. We had trusted the Lord for everything and we were safe in Gonavala village with Gonavala Sunil next door. How many of you know Gonavala Sunil? He was the worst criminal of that time. He had abducted the daughter of Dr. Paul and that's how he got infamous. And in Colombo, I felt so lonely and so